On November 9th, Safety Culture, in partnership with YouGov, will be releasing a research study detailing the needs of America's frontline workers. One of the key findings was that 70% of those surveyed stated that after pay, their key consideration when determining where to work was access to high-quality training. In order to help solve this problem, Safety Culture joined forces with EdApp, an award-winning mobile-first training solution that delivers 50,000 lessons per day in over 90 countries. Here to share more about EdApp and the problems we're solving, and to introduce our next great speaker, please welcome EdApp founder and CEO, Darren Winterford.
What a great afternoon we're having. How good was Roe? Fantastic. And also thinking back to Diane earlier, you know, that 56 hours in the water, I was trying to imagine how many training hours, you know, was required for that. 56 hours sounds to me like the tip of the iceberg. And that sounds really like thousands of hours of ocean swimming, which was, you know, just remarkable. So on the topic of training, I'd like to start by asking a few questions. The first one is, how many of us are really happy and satisfied with the quality of training that we're giving to our frontline workers at the moment? How many of us feel like they're super engaged with what they're seeing? And how many of us think that we could do this really differently? And at EdApp, we certainly do. We think that learning shouldn't necessarily be a 90-minute desktop mindless experience. And instead, it should be microbursts, small pieces of bite-sized learning. It shouldn't be a PDF or a PowerPoint in the canteen, you know, gathered around flicking through some slides. Instead, it should be delivered right out to a frontline worker's smartphone. And at EdApp, we're on a mission to do just that, to improve dramatically the quality of workplace training. And as Luke suggested earlier, and Bob just mentioned, you know, we're really happy with our progress with that mission. This year, we'll probably deliver something like 6 million lessons out to smartphone, the workers of smartphones across the world. And best of all, the large majority of them can actually use the product for free, which is fantastic. And we all recognize the importance of that. And let's go back to Diana. We recognize that there is a link between training and high performance, between quality and training, between great training and safety, for example, as we just heard from Roe. So the next speaker from Freedom Forever is a company that recognizes that link between training and high performance, training and safety. And they are on a massive mission. Their mission in the face of climate change is to become the number one residential solar installer in the United States. And here to tell us how they're going to achieve that mission is their head of internal comms, Edwin Dayrit. And we're going to hear from him now. And it's a great session. I think you're really, really going to enjoy it.
At Freedom Forever, we put ourselves in harm's way daily. Falls, electrical hazards, and many other factors and risks are part of our daily routine. Our safety policies are not just best practices. They are there specifically to keep our employees safe on a daily basis. But it takes integrity and drive from our employees to take it upon themselves to focus on the quality of their life and well-being to make the right choices. Safety isn't about following rules. It's about getting home to your loved ones and everything you work hard for. What inspires you to come home? What in your life could be impacted if you didn't? What would you miss? Who would miss you? This is why we work safe.
Good afternoon, everyone. In order to become extraordinary. We have to wake up every morning and choose extraordinary thoughts. Now, I can guarantee that nobody here in this room or anyone listening online wakes up and makes it their goal to be average or ordinary. And that is why all of us are here today, because collectively, we choose to strive for excellence. We choose every day to become extraordinary. Before we continue, I'd like to do a quick little visualization exercise. So I invite everyone to please close your eyes, take a big deep breath in, exhale, and visualize with me with your mind's eye a brighter and new world. Imagine taking a cross-country road trip, admiring the world's natural beauty, lavish oceans, beautiful landscapes, and never having once to refuel your car. Imagine flying from country to country in an airplane that needed no fuel. Imagine going to the airport and boarding a plane where the wings are made of solar panels and our aircrafts is powered by the sun. Now imagine a world where our lights, our computers, our appliances are all powered by the sun in our homes and in our buildings. Now how extraordinary would that world be to live in? I invite you to open up your eyes. Now that is the world that I want to live in the future. Because my extraordinary thought that I wake up with every single morning is to live in a world that is powered by clean energy. For me and hundreds of thousands of other people, we believe that climate change is real. Now here is a time lapse from a Google satellite showing over the last 37 years how much our glaciers are receding. Now this phenomenon is taken note by many countries all throughout the world. And the United States specifically is also responding to the science. Now let's take a look at how the solar industry has grown over the last few years in the United States. Here in a report by here in a report from SEIA, we can see that residential solar installations have doubled over the last 4 years. In this next report, we can see that solar installs remain to be the largest and most stable sector within the industry. So to summarize, solar is growing rapidly. And whether we agree or not that climate change is real, I think there is something that we can all agree on, and that is the huge beneficial economic impact that the solar industry has in the United States. Think about this. Hundreds of thousands of Americans are able to feed their family every day. Hundreds of thousands of Americans are able to power and consume their own energy totally off of the grid. Now that we've taken a look at the U.S. solar market, let's take a look at how Freedom Forever ranks in this market. So according to WoodMac's report in 2020, we can see that Freedom Forever is the third largest residential solar company in America. Not only that, we received Inc. 5000's fastest growing company award for the last 4 years. Now it is our goal to be number one, and we're not that far off. Here is what our growth has looked like over the last few years. Here's a map that shows that currently we are operating in 25 states with 33 branches nationwide and just shy of 2,000 employees. And it is our goal to expand to 40 states by the end of 2022. So to put things into perspective, I've kind of cut down the numbers a little bit for everyone to show how we have grown in the last 17 months. So we'll first start off with the number of states. Back in March 2020, we were operating in 8 states. Currently, to date, we operate in 25. There you go. All right. And then as far as our branches, back in March in 2020, we were operating in 12 branches. And to date, we operate in 33. As far as our employees, back in March, we were operating with 996 employees. And as of last week, we have 1,953 employees in just 17 months. So as you can see, we are growing rapidly. And that adding 20 to 30 new employees every single week poses a challenge. So from an operational standpoint as a company, we have to make sure that our onboarding, our training, our communication, all are on point and can keep up with our operational growth. We need to make sure that our internal employee experience is relevant, top-notch, and flexible with our flexible industry. And the way that we accomplished this was by sticking to a vision, because this airplane is flying high and we are growing every single day. So what keeps these 2,000 employees all on the same page? And for us at Freedom Forever, it starts with a vision. And here's a quote from our CEO, Brett Bushy, and it says, "We are a team focused on education, empowerment, and bringing integrity to our industry." Back in February 2020, when I was looking for a new position, I saw this quote, and these three words resonated with me so much. And that's why I'm here at Freedom Forever, because if I can work for a company that does these things for its employees, where we educate, we empower them, and we're telling the truth and being genuine, what great of a place would that be to work? Now, as far as other visions or core values that we have seven. Disruption, doing things unapologetically different from others in the industry. Other core values that we have is we embrace diversity. Safety is a top priority. We have collaboration, accountability, integrity, and also servant leadership, which is where every manager and every leader in the company, it is their top priority to serve those around them. It is through these core values that we are able to decide on what is best for the company in our rapidly growing market. What is best for the company in terms of what we need to communicate so that we can support our operations. Now, when it comes to communications in general, meaningful communications have purpose. There is a reason why we have a communications department. And it's not one of those departments where we're just the megaphone of the CEO. We are also problem solvers. And when partnered with operations in the right way, we can achieve so much. So in strategic communications, there's three main ingredients that we look for before we broadcast or send anything out. That is, number one, a problem, which is a clear definition of what is the current state of the company or the organization or a team. Do they know something? Do they not know something? What is their status? What are the contributing factors? What is the team or organization doesn't know? The second element is goal. What is the measurable and realistic measurement of success for this communication? Why are we sending this out? Why are we sending out this email? Why are we sending out this training? What is the goal? And then the last element is a solution. For every communication piece, we have a tactical plan on how to achieve success by means of communicating our training or whatever policy or process that needs to be communicated through our different channels. Here are a few examples of five different problems that we have solved through strategic communications. Number one, 45% of our employees, about 800 of them, risk their lives every single day by going on a roof and installing panels for homeowners. These 45% of our workforce are our field installers. They are our priority teammates when it comes to the solar industry because they are the ones who make it happen. So when it came to the problem of how do we disseminate and share training with our learners and our teammates all throughout the nation, we had to make a choice. And during this time, we were not able to send people all throughout the nation because of traveling restrictions, quarantining regulations. So we had to make a choice, and we chose a mobile training solution, which was EdApp. Now, this gave us the ability to put a success manual in every single employee's pocket. Now, this wasn't something just for the field workers, but even our employees that were at the branch and also at our HQ offices. EdApp was mobile friendly, and this gave the ability to provide engaging, bite-sized training that was easily consumable for our workforce. The second problem I'd like to walk you through is that as we were growing, we didn't have a platform to share wins. We didn't have a platform to share achievements. And that was something that was so important to us because that is what kept morale up, especially in the last 12 months of the pandemic. So what we've done is that we've created and repurposed the discussions feature within EdApp, our mobile LMS, and we've created something called the grid. The grid which connects our employees. Now, this is something where we have gave our employees the opportunity to share. And this is not just sharing achievements, but it's even sharing questions, sharing things that like, hey, I just got on this 45-degree pitch roof and I need help with how to install this. Easily take a picture, and then everyone by the droves responds and says, hey, bud, I think you can do this this way. This is what we've done in the branch down the street. Other ways where they use the grid is where we're able to share why our employees work safe. It provided that human element during a pandemic, which was so needed so that our workforce can stay connected. Problem three, the pandemic had an impact on the mental health of our employees. We knew that everyone was struggling, and it wasn't just Freedom for Our employees. So what we've done is we've created a year-long campaign focused on mental health awareness. Every single month, we would provide resources, desktop wallpapers, mobile wallpapers, so that everyone knew that we were thinking about them and that their mental health was a top priority. Problem four. Our internal communications team, by the way, just started around December of 2020. So we're just roughly 10, 11 months old. So being so new, our internal departments at Freedom Forever, which are running at a million miles an hour, by the way, as you can tell, they didn't know how to work with us or what value we provided. So one thing that we did a little bit differently is to make it easier for our stakeholders and different departments to understand, how do we work? What value can I provide you and your department? What success can I help push through communications and through training? So what we did is we created different types of service packages that helped resonate and that helped them remember what we do. So we had a base watt, kilowatt, megawatt, gigawatt package. And these different packages achieve different goals, achieve different objectives. So if I just want to send a new policy out, I'm just going to choose a base watt package. But if I want to drive operational change, and I want to be able to drive our teams towards a purpose through a new tool, I'm going to choose a gigawatt package because that means I'm sending out an email, probably 8 different touch points, as well as a full-on course within our LMS. The last challenge that I want to share with you is that we wanted to give employees a voice, a group where they can share openly. And as an internal communications team, we're not just the megaphone of leadership or the CEO, but we are also the megaphone of every single employee. And what we did is that we wanted to provide that feedback loop to our leaders of what's going well and what's not going well. So we established in the last few months a culture committee comprised of 30 individuals from different tenures and different roles within the company. We have a director of policy, we have a production manager, we have our director of construction there, we have a crew lead in that culture committee. We meet once a month and we say, what's working, what's not working? how is this branch doing and how is this region doing in terms of their training? And we provide that feedback to our leaders so that we can pivot quickly and move again towards success. So I go back to my original thought where I say, you know, extraordinary thoughts are things that we should choose every morning. The inception of Freedom Forever and the ideas that we implemented to support our operations, it all started with an extraordinary thought from our president, Greg Albright, about 10 years ago in a garage in Lake Elsinore. And I think about the growth that has happened over the last decade. Diana Nyad said it best, whatever we are thinking we are capable of, we can achieve. And I think that resonates so much because I think this entire summit is all about the power of being extraordinary, and it all starts with a plan, a vision, and a thought. So I'd like to end with the same quote that I started with. In order to become extraordinary, we have to wake up every morning and choose extraordinary thoughts. Now, why are extraordinary thoughts so important? Isn't it that our thoughts become actions, and our actions become behaviors, our consistent behaviors become habit, and our habit becomes our lifestyle, and our lifestyle becomes our destiny? What are examples of extraordinary thoughts from extraordinary people? Thomas Alva Edison, in the 1800s, had an extraordinary thought to bring light to all of the homes. In the 1960s, Russian and American scientists had an extraordinary thought to go to space. In 2006, a Silicon Valley startup company decided to bring to the mass market an electric vehicle. Now, how far off or an extraordinary thought is living in a world where our airplanes, our cars, our buildings are all powered by the sun? Choose extraordinary thoughts. That is my call to action. When we do that together as a team, we are able to achieve greatness. Choose extraordinary thoughts every single morning and see how much brighter your days become. Thank you.
Nice one. You want to stick around and have a chat?
Yeah, let's do it.
The first thing I've got to say is I didn't put any bets on for you.
Oh,
so I don't know your favorite football team, but I'll make you a deal.
Yeah.
After this, we'll go downstairs and we'll play the Bricky's laptop.
Let's do it.
The one-armed bandit. The pokies.
Yeah, okay.
$20, we're on.
All right.
Second question is not for you, but it's for everyone watching this at home. There's a flood of questions coming in for all our speakers. And can we just ask that you get involved early and request those questions early, just so the team's got time to go through them all, and then they can come up here to Edwin and I. Okay, fantastic. I'd like to go back to the beginning of your presentation. You talked about the growth. You know, it was ridiculous. I can't remember from how many states to how many. Talk me through that again, because I think this is the core of it.
Totally. And there's an industry word that we like to call, and in solar, and we call it the solar coaster. Mm-hmm. And roller coasters in general are and aren't for like, people love them, some people hate them, you know. And the growth that we had is extraordinary. But everyone that we work with is all about the fast-paced lifestyle that we have. So as far as your question, the numbers, you know, we started operating in 8 states, mm-hmm. and now we're in 25.
Yeah.
We had 12 branches throughout the nation. Currently, we're at 33.
Yeah.
And as far as employees, we've basically doubled. 1,000 in March 2020 and about 2,000, you know, this month. And we intend on hiring about 600 more in the next 6 months.
Wow. And when you're growing that fast, and, you know, you want these crews to be doing, you know, the best work of their lives. How do you manage to grow and manage the growth sustainably and safely and still keep, you know, the Freedom Forever vision alive in these crews as they go out there at such this rapid pace?
Absolutely. And it all has to do with, like, a unifying message. What are our managers saying all throughout the nation? What are we communicating with our teams? And I think that starting from the top with, you know, education and empowerment, that's a start. Yeah. But you have your monthly initiatives, you have your quarterly goals, and it's a matter of how we disseminate that information by means of obviously our meetings, mm-hmm. but also our communications and our training, and making sure that our communications and our training support those visions. Mm-hmm. That's how we kind of like keep things together.
Yeah. And we had a discussion that with this massive growth, we didn't want, or you didn't want to at all, I guess, put at risk any of your, you know, particularly your quality and your safety measures. And you mentioned that even though we have a, you know, almost a, you know, 300% growth in people, in states, but some of the key metrics in terms of safety and quality actually improved.
Oh, totally. I actually have an interesting comparison from how we did in our lost time rates from 2020 and the first three quarters of this year. So cumulatively in 2020, our lost time rate was about 1.8. Mm-hmm. And for the first three quarters of this year, mm-hmm. we are about at 0.6.
Right.
You know, and we've seen that dramatic improvement, not only through our training, but also in our safety.
So you've grown 300% and you've actually improved 300% as well.
Exactly.
That's pretty remarkable. For, I think, a lot of people, you know, here and a lot of people listening, onboarding that many people would be a really massive challenge. And traditionally, I think most people would recognize that onboarding, you know, is a real pain point. And you're looking to breed these extraordinary teams, and you're moving, you know, extremely fast. How did you approach onboarding and the onboarding challenge, you know, particularly in the face of COVID and everything else that's been happening?
Totally. We leveraged our technology, you know, and we had a hybrid onboarding scenario where we obviously have our managers who would do the face-to-face meetings and, you know, just, you know, welcome them and everything like that. Mm-hmm. But a large portion of our onboarding experience lived in our mobile LMS.
Yeah.
And the reason why we've taken that approach to input a lot of our content in our onboarding experience is because they're not going to remember everything, and we don't expect them to. And it's important that if they ever needed to figure out how to clock in, or they needed to go brush up on a safety procedure, mm-hmm. that they're able to expose and re-expose themselves as needed, mm-hmm. in a very engaging way.
Yep.
And it's something that provided that luxury and that ease for our employees.
Great. We do have a quick text question from the audience. And the question is, how did your teams take to mobile training? Was there any pushback, you know, getting, you know, a couple of thousand people to use mobile devices for training, I imagine, was a tough one.
Simple answer is there wasn't that much pushback, you know, and it was one of those things where, like, EdApp, our mobile LMS, was so easy to use. It's just like downloading another app from the App Store. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't a learning curve because the way that they formatted, mm-hmm. you know, the engagement and how to move across content, mm-hmm. is very similar to how you navigate your normal social media sites or your, yep. the games that you play, mm-hmm. on your free time. So yep. As far as, you know, our learners pushing back, there wasn't much.
And, yep. and there were no issues with them, for example, using their own devices. That hasn't come up, the fact that, you know, these team members are willing to use their own devices.
It was a non-issue for us, only because, you know, a lot of the training that they do is on company time.
Okay.
You know, and not only are they using, you know, their mobile device on their personal phone to get their training, but also they're using their mobile device to also clock in and clock out,
okay,
as
right.
needed. So it wasn't that big of an issue for us.
And I imagine that, you know, having training delivered in that format being so much more convenient than being, you know, having to sit through, you know, as you mentioned, sometimes some of the face-to-face elements, or at least making it a hybrid model, is something that they, you know, value much more.
Oh, totally. And it kind of cut down so much of our time, mm-hmm. in being able to push new process out.
Right.
You know, like, we have new tools, we have new processes, and it was very easy as for to send a notification to everybody that says, hey guys, we have a new tool, these are the three steps on how to do it, here's a quick little video, and
yep.
it's all on their phones.
Yeah.
With little to no communication from us.
And that's so important with, you know, dispersed teams and deskless workers.
Absolutely.
I have a final question, which is the fact that, you know, all roofs, I'm sure, are different. And, you know, your angle to the sun of California and New York is obviously extremely different. Talk to me about how important it is for your frontline workers to be able to share their solutions so that they can all, you know, hit best practice and absolutely nail it.
That is probably like the most popular feature that we have in our mobile LMS is the grid. Mm-hmm. And as I spoke earlier, like it's not just a place to share achievements and how hard you've worked and the quality of what you've done at the end of each day. Mm-hmm. But it's also an opportunity for our installers to share like, hey, I have a 45 degree pitch roof, mm-hmm. or I have a main panel upgrade and I don't know how to do this. Mm-hmm. And it gives them the ability to right then and there post a question, post a video, post a photo. Mm-hmm. And you have people in neighboring branches, in neighboring states that encounter the same type of like issues. And they're able to provide solutions. And that's not an email. That's not a phone call. Yep. That's real-time social learning. And I think that's the most valuable part of what we've done is that we provided that platform and encouraged them to help each other because peer-to-peer learning is just taking off right now.
That's such a good point because there's a lot of, I guess, buzzwords around social learning. And I think, you know, a lot of people probably aren't very clear on what it is, but that's a great example. So they're sharing solutions almost live and they're asking questions live. You know, here's how I approached a certain installation or how do I approach a certain installation? And can they do that in real time? Like, can they do that on the job?
Oh, yeah. Like, right before getting on the stage, I was just taking a look at the grid and I saw, like, mm-hmm. two different scenarios already of, you know, people asking for help.
Yeah. Well, that was a fantastic keynote. Thanks very much. Everyone, please show your appreciation for EJ. Fantastic. Thanks again, Matt.
Thanks.
Just before we move on, I also wanted to do a shameless plug. And the shameless plug, you heard me talking earlier about the fact that we're on a mission to really change training. And what I'd like to challenge you to do, and again, everyone watching at home or wherever you're watching virtually, is to jump onto Google and type in trade in your training. Very simple, trade in your training. And what we'd like to propose is that go and grab your dusty PowerPoint or PDF, whatever it is that you have that you're currently training with, and just give us one deck. And you can upload it. So you just go to trade in your training into Google. You'll be taken to a site that will say trade in your training by safety culture. Upload that document, and overnight we'll have something back in a mobile microlearning format for you to have a look at. And then we can have a discussion about how we can help empower your frontline workers with providing them training like that instead of PDF and PowerPoint and some of those other disasters. Thanks very much.